In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
I welcome you to Mass on this feast day in England of St. Augustine of Canterbury. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. Lord Jesus, you have revealed yourself as the way to the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You have poured out on your people the Spirit of truth.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest,
and on earth peace to people of goodwill.
We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you,
we give you thanks for your great glory.
Lord God, heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father,
Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son,
Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father,
you take away the sins of the world,
have mercy on us.
You take away the sins of the world,
receive our prayer.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father,
have mercy on us.
For you alone are the Lord,
you alone are the Lord,
you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ,
with the Holy Spirit,
in the glory of God the Father.
Let us pray. Almighty God, who by the mission of the Bishop of St. Augustine of Canterbury called the English people into the wondrous light of the Gospel, grant through his intercession, we pray, that faithful to that same Gospel proclaimed, we may strive to make known your truth and build up your Church on the foundations he laid. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God for ever and ever.
Amen.
News to you in the face of great opposition.
Salute no one on the road. Whatever house you go into, let your first words be, peace to this house. And if a man of peace lives there, your peace will go and rest on him. If not, it will come back to you. Stay in the second house, taking what food and drink they have to offer, for the labourer deserves his wages. Do not move from house to house. Whenever you go into a town where they make you welcome, eat what is set before you, cure those in it who are sick, and say, the kingdom of God is very near to you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
St. Augustine of Canterbury, and to distinguish him from St. Augustine of Hippo, connects the English Church to Rome. Chosen by Pope St. Gregory the Great, he is appointed as the apostle to England to consolidate the church here in the south, which was still largely pagan. In the north, in Wales and Cornwall, the church had been established by Celtic missionaries who were rather suspicious of the Roman church, seeing it as an extension of their Roman occupiers. After the fall of the Roman Empire and the withdrawal of the legions, the inhabitants here were left to defend themselves against Saxon attacks. Pope St. Gregory, on seeing some British slaves being sold in Rome, said, "Who are they?" And he was told that they were the Angles. And he said, "No, not Angles, but angels. And they need a mission to bring them the freedom of the gospel." It took two attempts for Augustine to reach England. They were stopped by the Gauls, who warned them of the perils that they would face. It's always the French, isn't it? And they turned Augustine back, and they were back to Rome. St. Gregory, issuing Augustine letters of commendation, sent him out once more. And Augustine and his monks landed at Ramsgate on the Isle of Thanet. But actually, he was received very well by King Ethelbert of Kent, who had recently married Bertha, a Christian princess. Therefore, with royal support, but very importantly, without any force, they began their mission, quickly winning many converts to the faith. I think that's not least because Augustine had a very good grasp of the scriptures, but he was also a very good administrator. The following year, Augustine was consecrated a bishop, and on hearing of the many conversions, St. Gregory sent him a pallium, raising him to the dignity of an archbishop, but also very importantly, that sign of unity with Rome. Augustine was only in England for 8 years before his death, but clearly he had a positive impact. It was very quickly that the people were declaring him saintly. He had a delicate task, however. Yes, the people had embraced Christianity, but they were still rather attached to their old practices. And so Augustine purified many pagan temples, setting them aside now for Christian worship. And he gently removed ideas not compatible with the gospel. We still have to do that today sometimes, don't we? And he aligned the pagan feasts with those of the martyrs. And he discovered that there was an ancient church on the site in Canterbury, and that's where he built his church. Augustine consecrated 12 suffragan bishops, giving him authority over the church in England. Let's not confuse that with the later Church of England, which was created by Henry VIII. So Augustine's see in Canterbury had primacy, not London. It's been quite controversial, I imagine. So Canterbury becomes the focus for English Christianity, until, of course, here was Henry VIII and his and the apostolic succession is broken. And of course now, the metropolitan see that we all focus on is Westminster, and Catholic Canterbury is now under the Archdiocese of Southwark, under Archbishop John Wilson. Perhaps we could controversially suggest, therefore, that the real Archbishop of Canterbury is John Wilson. Today we pray, therefore, always for our separated brethren, that they may return with us to Rome and their apostolic origin. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God, our friend.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine, the work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God, amen.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and of all his holy church.
Grant our supplication, we pray, Almighty God, that with these sacrificial offerings of your people, which we bring on the feast of St. Augustine, you will graciously mingle the gifts of heaven through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you,
and with your spirit.
Lift up our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as on the feast of St. Augustine you bid your church rejoice, so too you strengthen her by the example of his holy life, teach her by his words of preaching, and keep her safe in answer to his prayers. And so with the company of angels and saints we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts,
to accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unburned sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant, Francis our Pope, and Richard our Bishop, and all those who hold him to the truth, and on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves, and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Titus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Christogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damien, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, the supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith, we proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who seek in Christ a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants who live sinners, hope in your abundant mercies. Graciously grant and share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcel, Linus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord, for whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For Deliver us all, we pray, from every evil, gracious to grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Thank you.
Let us pray. As we rejoice at the feast day of St. Augustine, we have received the pledge of eternal redemption, O Lord, and we pray that it may be of help to us, both now and for the life to come, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So starting this evening at 7 p.m. with Adoration of the Blessed Sacrament is the diocesan invited Novena to the Holy Spirit every evening at 7 p.m. in this church, culminating with the extended vigil of Pentecost, which is at 6 p.m. on Saturday the 4th of June. It starts this evening at 7. There are hard copies in the porch for you. If you want to print one from the parish newsletter section of the website, you can do so as well. On the weekends, the meeting will be straight after the evening Mass. If you normally come to Mass on Saturday mornings, remember this week that the Saturday weekday Mass is 1 p.m. and it's at St. Martha's, and it's the nuptial Mass for Saul Butler and Gabriella Gerard Badara. So there's no Mass at 10 tomorrow. Mass is 1 p.m. It's at St. Martha's. It's a wedding Mass, a nuptial Mass. There's a little basket over by the sorry, altar from the S&P if you wish to place a prayer intention, which is going to Aylesford Marian Shrine on the 14th of June. I think it's on the top of my head. So there's a basket if you wish to petition to be taken if you can't go on that pilgrimage. Happy feast day. The Lord be with you.
Amen.
May God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Arajim Hachem.